Folks, one of my favorite things is when two disparate stories that I want to talk about click together in some ways, and when you really think about it, they're actually far more connected than they seem, especially on the surface. But they really have a common theme often, and the common theme is cowardice. And that's, of course, what we're talking about as it pertains to old Donnie, because he recently took a trip to the UK, but now he's in Ireland. And protesters there not only hucked rotten eggs at him and protested him brutally, and he was taken down in an absolutely humiliating way by law enforcement in Ireland, and we're going to talk about that. The reason he was out there was, yes, ostensibly for his golf courses, but he was supposed to be attending a meeting to plan out the GOP debates that apparently he wants to skip. And he was supposed to be at a meeting, he and his team, to discuss the scheduling and template and, you know, format of these early debates. And he purposely planned a trip to Europe to not be there so he could avoid that. So a whole bunch of people, including some conservatives that used to support Trump, are calling him an absolute coward. First of all, I just want to show you just some of the pictures of the protesters. Then we're going to get into how this trip was structured around avoiding any of this debate before we get into the most humiliating and criminalizing part of all of this for Trump still in Ireland.
You know, the presidency is not a scripted exercise. And so that's why I think debates are important, and I think we should participate in them. And to the extent that President Trump doesn't want to participate in them, people should wonder why. And I think it's because he doesn't have a lot of serious answers for the problems that are facing the country right now. All he wants to do is go back and re-prosecute the 2020 election because his feelings are hurt. He's a child in that regard.
Now, he does have one good point, Governor. He's got like a 30-40 point lead over everyone. Governor DeSantis in second place. And he says, why would someone this far ahead debate? And what's your response to that?
Because this is about letting the American people decide who's best prepared to be president. This is not running for student body president. And if he really cares about the country, and I have deep questions about that, but if he really cares about the country, that he's going to get up there, and he shouldn't be afraid. I'm sorry to see that Donald Trump feels like if he gets on the stage, he's at risk of losing his lead. If, in fact, his ideas are so great, if his leadership is so outstanding, then his lead will only increase if he gets on the stage, not decrease. But obviously, he's afraid. He's afraid to get on the stage against people who are serious. And I'm sorry to see that he's that afraid of it. If he's that afraid of that, how can we count on him to do any better with President Xi than the failures he had in his first term with China? How can we expect him to do any better with Putin than having set the groundwork for the invasion of Ukraine, which his conduct towards Putin certainly helped to establish? This is a guy who seems like he's afraid. And if he's afraid, he has no business being president.
And that people are going to have to be answering over the next year and a half, because it looks like Donald Trump is going to be the nominee of the Republican Party. I mean, it's way too early to tell, but certainly doesn't look like he has any comers right now that are going to be strong enough. And I'll just say up front, you know, Chris Licht, I've known Chris for a very long time, good friend, and helped us all start this show. Also know Zaz and friends with Zaz. But Mike Barnicle, the question that a lot of people are talking about is whether CNN should, whether they should set up a town hall meeting with the likely GOP nominee, because, and the question, you know, the guy's an insurrectionist. The guy tried to overthrow the United States government. He's not just any other presidential candidate. There are people saying you don't provide that sort of normalcy. Others saying, well, he's going to be the GOP nominee. So how do we handle it? This CNN decision to air this town hall meeting is a good first sort of pass at what do we do? Where do you draw the lines in 2024 with an insurrectionist, the guy who said he's wanted to terminate the Constitution? A guy who promotes violence, openly promotes violence. What does the media do?
You have him on, and you press him on all the points that you just raised, and you don't give him any wiggle room, you don't let him do his abandonment of the facts routine, you just keep pressing him on it and point out that he is an insurrectionist. You point out the fact that he did try to overthrow the American government, actively tried to overthrow it. You point out that he's a liar. You point out all the flaws and you keep pointing them out. Now, I don't know whether you can do that in the context of a town meeting. We're going to find out, Jonathan, next week, whether you can do it in the context of a town meeting. But that's what you should do. Yeah. That's what you would do.
Yeah. And Caitlin Collins is a terrific interviewer, covered him at the White House, and she's hosting this. But Mara, this does raise all sorts of questions. This is not just any other candidate, as Joe says. This is an insurrectionist candidate. And some have said that if we treat him like any other politician, that's a sign right there that our democracy is failing. I mean, to Mike's point, certainly you have to hold him accountable. You have to have context. You have to have facts. That is harder maybe in this setting where it's not just a one-on-one interview. They're going to be, we assume, questions from the audience, questions that may or may not be screened. And we know Donald Trump has the ability to filibuster, to just steamroll over people and questions. What's your take? How should we be doing this?
Oh, you know, I don't have a $1 million silver bullet answer for this, but I'm glad we're talking about it, because I think in 2016, the media in some ways, we kind of just felt, even personally, steamrolled just by never having experienced anything like this. And the reality is, if he's a serious candidate again, and that's something that the voters decide, then you can't ignore a serious presidential candidate. And so it puts the media in a very difficult position. So you do have to kind of ask him the tough questions. I agree. I mean, one solution, and just as a small example, is if you have a town hall situation, you can provide context to viewers in real time. Fact checking, for example, is going to be very important. Really having an aggressive, very competent moderator is really important. So those are the things that make the difference between someone being interviewed by a seasoned journalist or having a debate, a spirited debate, and just propaganda and providing a free platform and so much of that free media that Donald Trump got in 2016. You know, he wasn't held to account. It was just endless coverage of Donald Trump.
That you know who and Biden, should they participate in debates? That was the question. Because I guess you know who decided he might not participate.
Oh, he don't want to participate.
Well, he probably doesn't. I mean, you know, but they have a clip saying, well, you'll see. I don't have to tell you. You'll see. Show the clip.
I'm leading by 40 points. And a lot of people say, why would you do a debate when you have people at 2 and 3 and 15 and 14, people don't debate when they have these massive leads. They say, why would we debate? And I have a hostile group of anchors, a hostile network asking questions. Why would I do that?
But if he really cares about the country, then he's going to get up there and he shouldn't be afraid. I'm sorry to see that Donald Trump feels like if he gets on the stage, he's at risk of losing his lead. If, in fact, his ideas are so great, if his leadership is so outstanding, then his lead will only increase if he gets on the stage, not decrease. But obviously he's afraid.
But I know that the president does not have a fear or concern about debating anybody. I mean, if you recall, there were, I don't even know how many people were up on the stage when he debated before.
So, I mean, what is going on?
I love how Trump was like, it's a hostile network and anchor. He's talking about Fox News and Bret Baier. This is like the friendliest network to him, and he's still afraid to get on stage. It's such a shame. Like, when he frames it, the way he says is basically, well, I have the lead, so I shouldn't have to, and they're hostile to me, so why would I do it? Because it's for the country. When you run for president, you run to serve the country. When you debate, you work to earn voters' votes. Mm-hmm. He's not willing to do that. He thinks he should just be coronated, which is funny because he came after Hillary Clinton for, like, in the Democrats in 2016, like, it's a coronation. He needs to debate. He needs to get challenged on his ideas. And by the way, he has not been on a debate stage against other Republicans since 2016. Right. So think of the impeachments, the investigations. January 6th has happened. He's been indicted. He needs to answer tough questions. And by the way, there's also a really big chance he'll be on stage next to Mike Pence, his former vice president, who a mob wanted to kill on January 6th because Trump incited a riot.
Didn't they come for President Biden when they kept saying, Joe's in the basement and he won't come out or something when they weren't debating. I think the problem with the former president is he wants fans, not opponents. So he loves a rally. He wants people that are like-minded, that are cheering him on. The problems come when he's questioned on things. The reason I want to see him in these debates with other candidates is we watched how this party has been held hostage by Donald Trump, and we watch as...
So you can see, right? Everyone thinks it's cowardice. It's cowardice, it's arrogance, it's ego, it's fear, and I think it's based on a whole bunch of things. He's, you know, some of it's, you know, strategy. You're winning, according to the polls, and you're winning by a lot, according to most of them. So why risk it, right? Like, that's one of the arguments. Another is, you know, Donald Trump is as much as he likes to attack the current president, the current guy, the former guy's brain is mush, and he has a hard enough time giving a speech on a stage with a teleprompter. How is he going to do in an actual debate? 2.5 years ago now, he was horrid on that stage against Joe Biden. Came off awful. You know, maybe there was a chance Trump could have won that election. Certainly after that first debate with Biden, it was over. Joe Biden was going to be president. You know, when he said, "Man, will you shut up?" he spoke for the world. You remember that? You guys remember that? And so Trump, in an unstructured, this isn't 2016 Trump, who was evil but with a semi-functioning brain. This is an evil man with no brain. And so we get back to Ireland, and, like, again, they had more cops there than protesters to guard Trump from the eggs that were being hucked, the boos and the heckles that were being hucked, because there were more protesters there than Trump supporters and more cops than Trump supporters, all for a man visiting. And we know that the Irish people will come out and be very kind to a U.S. president they like. We saw that with, again, Joe Biden. But with Donald Trump, it's not the case. And if anything, it's really highlighting his criminality, as a lot of people are saying, that this dude needs to go down for not only his national crimes, but his international ones as well.